Welcome to Taival Outdoors. My name is Joel. Today we are in my gear room, Varusto, and we will talk a bit about my sleeping bags and maybe sleeping bags in general, ranging from my winter sleeping bags to my three-season military bags, blankets, summer bags, and also let's look at bag liners or inner bags, as well as some bivvy bags and why I use all of those things together. But to be able to compare these bags and looking at them more closely, we first have to understand where do the temperature ratings or limits come from. So there has been a sleeping bag testing standard since 2005, and that standard was updated in 2017. Originally, the testing gave four results, so upper limit, comfort, lower limit, and extreme, but this new or the current standard doesn't have the upper limit anymore, so there's just the three other numbers usually if you go out now and buy a sleeping bag. But generally speaking, comfort is considered to be the temperature limit for an average woman. Limit is the same number for an average man. And then extreme is, well, it is what it sounds like. In fact, extreme reflects the temperature where you should not die of hypothermia, at least immediately, but you are pretty damn close to it and in for a miserable night. And this is especially important to understand regarding winter sleeping bags. But there are some problems or issues you have to be aware of. So first of all, not all manufacturers use this standard. The standard doesn't cover kids or baby sleeping bags, and it doesn't also apply to military sleeping bags or those sleeping bags that are meant for really extreme climates. So think about expeditions and such. Those type of sleeping bags are outside of the scope of this standardization. And secondly, sleeping comfort and warmth is highly individual, and your sleeping pad and clothing have a bigger impact than sleeping bag manufacturer would let you to believe. Only by experience you will figure out what works for you in what conditions. For example, if you are a guy but tend to sleep a bit colder, then look for the comfort number, the so-called women's rating. Also women, you have sleeping bags that are better suited for your average body shape. Similarly, I have to buy bags that are meant for taller individuals such as myself, and that of course comes with additional bulk, additional weight, and sometimes additional cost. So it is what it is, but as a rule of thumb, buy a bag that fits your body. It should not be too big, because if it's too big, then your body heat isn't going to be enough to warm the air inside the bag. Because the bag itself, of course, doesn't come with a heater. You are the heater inside the bag. The bag just insulates that heat, keeps it close to your body, and you generate your own warmth, so to speak. All right, let's start then looking at this bag. So from your right, this is my winter sleeping bag, Marmot Never Summer Long. Bought this in December 2016. Price was 290 euros. That's still to this date by far my most expensive sleeping bag purchase, and also one of the reasons why I don't want to buy a bag that would handle minus 30 degrees or so is because there are very few minus 30 degrees trips I can take during winter season, and then there's a question if I even want to do that, and also then the price. You know, good down sleeping bags are costly. 300 euros, but it has been worth every penny, in my opinion. This one has a comfort rating of minus 10, limit of minus 18, and extreme minus 39. Although it's not visible there anymore, but that's what it used to say. Filling is 650 down. And as the case is with sleeping bags and other down products these days, it is treated with something that makes it a bit more resistant towards moisture and water, but down is down. There is no way around it. It doesn't handle wet conditions very well, so good to keep in mind. And I have the storage bag here, and I think this clearly indicates why I like to keep my sleeping bags like this. If you have the room and the storage keep your sleeping bags like this, hang them from the ceiling. This keeps the insulation, the loft in good shape, and also after your trips, they dry a lot quicker this way than if you would keep them in their massive storage sacks. So there's that. So good to about minus 18. Last winter I slept in minus 20, where I had this bag and then this one inside of it. So this is perhaps the bag that I've slept most nights in. This is Rab, R-A-B, Ascent 300 XL. It is also a down bag. This one has the comfort rating of 6.5 degrees, limit 1.5 degrees, and extreme, I believe that has been minus 13 degrees. But despite all these three numbers, it still says there that it is 1 degree back, or 34 Fahrenheit bag for you Americans out there. Bought it in May 2018, but this was 2017 model, so I got it for 179 euros. And if there is one piece of advice that I would like to give to my younger self about backpacking gear in general, I would say save up some money and buy a down bag that's good to about 0 degrees, or +1, +3 degrees. Kind of a three-season down bag. Just the amount of hours and nights spent with this easily justify the 179 euros cost, and this is basically my go-to bag most of the year. Made with similar 650 hydrophobic down as my winter sleeping bag. Then this is my latest addition to the sleeping bag collection. This is Carinthia Defence 1 Top. And I bought this for two reasons. First and foremost, I wanted to have a good bag that I can also borrow to my friends and relatives. For example, now I went to Lapland last time with my brother, and actually I have two brothers, and originally both of them were supposed to come, and so by acquiring this I would have had sleeping bags for both. But the main reason is that I want to have my own sleeping bag for military exercises. I do go to 2 to 4 exercises per year. Of course, we get issued clothing and gear over there, but Finnish military only uses one sleeping bag, as far as I know. And that is Carinthia, or that is the same as Carinthia Defence 6, and that is a winter sleeping bag. And I don't really need that massive, like this big sleeping bag during the spring, summer, or fall. So I finally did the purchase, got Defence 1 Top. This, again, I would consider to be a 0 degree bag, and so far my experiences seem to reflect that. But the testing standard I mentioned earlier, it also doesn't apply to military sleeping bags, so that's why it's a bit hard to compare these items with the civilian bags, because Carinthia only says that this bag has a comfort rating of +4, and in civilian bags, comfort meant the women's rating, so that the higher kind of a limit. So there's comfort, then limit, then extreme. So this would have a comfort rating of +4, but is it then comparable to the civilian bags? I have no idea. So I would say 0 degrees bag as a standalone without the inner, but we'll talk about the inner bags or the liners in just a second. And again, this is the tall or long version, which, by the way, did come with additional cost. So that's sometimes the unfortunate, but very real thing. Then, moving on to my only blanket. So this is something that those of you who follow my channel have seen recently popping up. This is the Tuco Systems Hybrid Field Blanket. There you have it. It is a blanket, but it does have a zipper and can be used like normal sleeping bag as well. This comes in two versions. This is the lighter one. The price for this is $75. Not available in Europe, but I got it for free back in 2019 because the guy who makes this wanted to ship one to me and ask for my, well, not review, but my feedback, as I'm testing a lot of gear and I've purchased a lot of his other stuff over the years and kind of introduced to Go systems to Finland and perhaps to Europe as well. So there's that. The point about this is that it can be used as a blanket or as a sleeping bag or even as an underquilt with a hammock, and it does have a reflective layer inside. So although it's quite thin, it's still perhaps warmer than what it looks like. There is no official standardized testing done for these, but the manufacturer estimates the limits to be roughly 15 degrees, then 12 degrees, and the extreme to be -1 degrees. Personally, I would say that around 10 degrees is reasonable limit for this, then combined with bivvy bag goes closer to that 0 degree mark. But especially considering that this is the lighter version of the two, that's not bad. And the thicker one, I think it has double the insulation amount. I would say that that goes to 0 degrees quite easily with the bivvy bag at least. And then finally, out of all of these, these has to be the oldest sleeping bag that I still have. I've had other sleeping bags over the years, but I've sold those away when I've gotten new ones or upgrades and so forth. This, believe it or not, is made by Savotta back in 2013. So yeah, the same Finnish brand, Savotta, that makes those very high quality backpacks. They used to do a lot of kind of these cheap Chinese or something products that were only branded as Savotta and not really manufactured here. I believe this was one of them. Got it, yeah, like I said, 2013. And I believe the price for this was, all of these, or these two, maybe the liners as well, and these are all bought from different kind of discounts and so forth, and I believe this was either 20 or 30 euros. It's a summer sleeping bag, in a very bad shape, of course, because it is so old and it's quite poorly manufactured. But the good thing about this is that it goes to this, so in very small package. And I believe this still has the, yeah, this one has, like I mentioned, there has been the old standard, and then the new standard has only three different numbers. I'm not sure if this has actually been through the standardized testing, but it does have four numbers at least. So this ranges from upper limit of +29 degrees to the comfort of +21 degrees, lower limit +11, and then extreme +7. I'd say that's pretty accurate. I'm only using this during summer when the night temperatures are definitely over 10 degrees, so close to maybe 15 degrees and upwards if that's ever the case. Then yeah, it's still a usable bag. Although it has started to, you know, fail me quite badly. And I don't know really what kind of bag I will ever get to replace this, if anything. The small packing size is the only thing that it has going on for it. So maybe I just don't get anything once this fails for good and just use this blanket instead. All right, that's all my sleeping bags. Let's move to sleeping bag liners. And personally, I've been a big believer in sleeping bag liners for years. Mainly for one reason only, and that is not the possible additional warmth that they add, but instead I don't have to wash my sleeping bags when I'm using a liner. That is such a big deal to me, especially because I'm using a down sleeping bag most of the time. So wearing a liner and then washing that liner every now and then, that was a bit of a game changer and a big eureka moment for me when I heard about that. So my main liner is made by Cocoon. It's a silk liner and it takes only this much space. It's a bit pricey, around 70 euros when I got this, but it is silk, so it feels nice. It doesn't weigh anything at all. Super lightweight, goes to very small package and has been with me all these years on practically every trip. It's a very simple construction, no zippers or anything, but it's quite easy to get in and out because the you can see the size of this thing. That's not a problem even for someone like me. So silk liner, definitely a good investment if you are using down sleeping bags or any liner for that matter, but if you're going to spend multiple nights and especially year-round use, then I think silk liner is worth the extra investment. Then I only have actually two liners. Silk liner I use with everything else except this Carinthia bag, and inside of this bag I have Carinthia's own liner. It is Polycotton liner, and the reason I use this with the Carinthia bag is that first of all it's tied with I believe 6 of these loops to the bag itself, so it doesn't move, it's always facing the same direction. And secondly, I wanted to have a liner there, yes, so that this I don't have to wash this, but because also in military exercises a lot of the times you just go into the bag wearing all of your clothes, sometimes even wearing your shoes. Personally, I don't really do that. I know a lot of guys do, but you know, anyway, even with just your clothes on, which you've been, you know, wearing and crawling through the forest with those, they're really dirty, smell bad, have all sorts of vegetation and everything on them. So having a liner inside of this bag then again protects the actual bag, so I don't have to wash this at least so often. I can just then remove the liner and wash it. And one pro tip, if you will, only close this inner liner maybe to halfway. That way, if you have to quickly get out of your sleeping bag, you don't have to try to unzip two full zippers. You can just unzip the main zippers of this defense one top and then just crawl out of the bag. At least I found that in the last exercises where I used this combination for the first time to be the right way for me to use it. But all right, that's all my sleeping bags, my one blanket, my two liners, and then let's jump into bivvy bags. And I am a big believer in bivvy bags. I know many people who don't like them and they fear the condensation and so forth, but I've used bivvy bags since 2016 and I don't think there has been a single trip during these years where I haven't had a bivvy bag with me. I might be wrong on that, but maybe like on 95% of the cases when I've gone on out, I'm quite sure that I've had a bivvy bag. But no, actually, that's a lie. I've used bivvy bags way before that. I was going to talk about these two, but this is my first bivvy bag. This has to be from 2014. Might have been even 2013, but at least 2014. This is British military surplus Gore-Tex, or at least it was claimed to be sold as Gore-Tex bivvy bag. It is gigantic. And that is also one of the reasons why I haven't really used this in many years. But before I got these two, I did wear this one, and yeah, it is one size fits all solution, and as you can see, it can definitely fit a person who is way bigger than I am. Taped seams on the inside, but because it is genuine military product, it's not super heavy, but it is quite bulky. So there is that. So yeah, I'm correcting myself. I've been using bivvy bags at least from 2014. So from the learnings from that bivvy bag, I then got, well, actually neither one of these, but in a very similar package and exactly the same size, I got two Go Systems Trifecta version 2 back in 2016. And that is actually now in my car kit. It is a product that can be used as a tarp or a bivvy bag. Then I got this one, 2017 Velar UL bivvy, again by Two Go Systems. I've used this a lot. So since I got this, I pre-ordered this in 2017. Yeah, now I remember. I might have gotten this only in 2018, but anyway, used this a lot as a bivvy bag. This cannot be used as a tarp or anything, so this is a bit lighter, although it goes down to similar size. Maybe a bit smaller, but definitely lighter. And now I'm using Two Go Systems BOB or Bob zippered poncho, because this is, well, as the name says, this is a poncho, but this can be used as a bivvy bag as well. And because I'm carrying poncho anyway, now I can, you know, get rid of the poncho and just use this as both my bivvy bag and a poncho. And the beauty of all of these Two Go Systems products, these this poncho, Velar UL, and the Trifecta, is that it's made of reflective, heat-reflective Tyvek material, so it's completely waterproof and kind of looks like a space blanket from the other side. And then the other side is this greenish color, and that does add a bit of additional warmth to whatever sleeping bag you are using underneath. So it might sound a bit crazy that even during summer I'm still using a liner, a sleeping bag, and a bivvy bag. But liner keeps the sleeping bag clean, keeps it in good condition. And bivvy bag is something that I use a lot because, maybe it's important to mention here, I sleep a lot under a tarp, or now these days in my pyramid-shaped kind of tent, but it doesn't have a floor, which means that sleeping bag is very likely to get contact with the ground. Even if I'm trying to stay on the sleeping bag, there's still a very high chance of me slipping out of it during the night. So it makes sense to protect the bag from the inside as well as from the outside. And that is the reason why all of these, besides this Carinthia bag, are starting to be quite old bags. And these two, which are kind of my premium bags, I'm planning to use these for a long time. They don't show any signs of wear and tear, although I've slept countless of nights in both. And what I know of the quality of this Carinthia bag, I'm sure that this will last me easily over 10 years. So being smart about how I store these, how I use them, how I protect them from my own sweat and dirt and things like that that I might bring into the bag, as well as the outside elements with the bivvy bag, I'm able to really extend the life of those sleeping bags, no matter the season, no matter in what conditions I use them, and have, in the end, more bang for my buck, I think. Bit of a long video, as always, but I think it was worth it. Thank you so much for watching. Let me know any comments, questions down below, and I will see you all in the next one. Bye.